Hi, it's Kiffin Lebates here, and video 18 in a series commissioned by the Helsinki Blockchain Center. And in today's video, I'm going to answer a question asked to me by Vaya Papathanasiou, who asked the question, can you please explain the different kinds of tokens there are in blockchain? And what I'm going to do is my usual thing of stepping back a bit and explaining what tokens actually are, because one of the problems we have when we're faced with terms such as cryptocurrency or coins or tokens is that it conjures up an image in our mind. So if I talk about crypto coins, the image that you get is of actual coins being handed backwards and forwards between people. And there are no coins on blockchains. This is the fundamental thing you have to understand. Blockchains are ledgers, and ledgers are like spreadsheets, except that they serve a specific purpose, which is to record who owned what when. So it's like a spreadsheet, and each row tells you what things there are and who owns them, and then if they transferred them at some later date to somebody else. And that is how coins and tokens and cryptocurrencies are instantiated on blockchains, because blockchains are kind of a distributed ledger or distributed spreadsheet where everybody has the same copy of all the records. And remember, once again, the records say what there is and who owns it and possibly who it's been transferred to. So it's kind of like a sort of accountancy thing that's going on here. Now we can dig a bit deeper into the different kinds of tokens that there are. And by token, we're effectively talking about a row in the ledger or a row in the spreadsheet that's being instantiated by the blockchain. And the most fundamental type of token you can have is something that I refer to as a native cryptocurrency. This is where the blockchain itself has the code in the blockchain at the very base level, instantiates those rows and keeps track of how many tokens there can be and who owns them. So for example, if we take Bitcoin, at the fundamental level of Bitcoin, it's keeping a record of the creation of Bitcoins, every block, which are on their creation assigned to the miner who mined them. And then it keeps track of when they're transferred onto other people. And in fact, it's a bit tricky because the model within Bitcoin isn't quite a balances ledger one. There are these things called transaction inputs and outputs, but that's a further complication, which I won't go into here. Effectively, Bitcoin is one big ledger, and it has records throughout the blockchain that when you put them in the correct order and in a list, you end up with like an accountancy ledger saying who owns what Bitcoins, and then later on who they transfer them to, and now that person has a record saying they own them. And you have the same on Ethereum. There's the Ethereum native cryptocurrency, it's called Ethers, and got some interesting lighting effects going on here. And Ethers are like Bitcoins in that the base level of the Ethereum blockchain keeps effectively a record of who owns what ethers, and when more ethers are created, who gets them, and so on and so forth. Now, tokens on Ethereum are a bit different, because what you're doing on Ethereum when you're creating a token is you're actually submitting a smart contract to the blockchain, and that smart contract instantiates another ledger. Another ledger is created in the blockchain for each token that is issued on the blockchain. So now you have the Ethereum blockchain, which is a long sequential immutable ledger. And then within it, you have programs that are stored that themselves keep a record of the tokens that they create in their own ledger within the ledger. So it gets a bit complicated there. And then the question is, well, what kind of ledgers can you instantiate? And the two fundamental ones are non-fungible tokens and fungible tokens. And I'll deal with the fungible tokens first. Fungible tokens, these are called the ERC20 tokens because they're named after the standard that people follow so that all the different protocols can intercommunicate and operate with each other. So usually fungible tokens are instantiated using ERC20, and you create a ledger, and each row in the ledger has an address for somebody and their balance. And then when somebody transfers some of those tokens to somebody else, what the smart contract does is it decrements the balance of the first person and increments the balance of the second person by the same amount. And that effectively is a way of transferring something from one person to another. Now, in the real world, of course, if I have a bag of coins and I transfer them to you, I hand the bag over to you, and it's a wonderful property of the material world that physical objects can't be in two places at the same time. So I have transferred the bag of coins to you. Now you have them instead of me. The universe kind of keeps track of the balance for us. What a smart contract has to do, it has to make sure that the algorithm is in place so that when you send a transaction asking to transfer some or all of your balance to somebody else, that it actually correctly decrements your balance and increments the receiver's balance. If it does that wrong, then you haven't got sort of conservation of coin mass, and your smart contract will look very odd to the outside world. There are actually circumstances where you don't just decrease one balance and increase the other one by the same amount. If you wanted to have an automatic tax on each transaction, you could decrease one person's balance by X and increase the other person's balance by X minus delta, and increase the tax collector's balance by the delta. That would give you an automatic sales tax on every transaction. So this is the kind of wonderful flexible thing that you can do with smart contracts. And this is why smart contractors programmers get excited by all the possibilities that there are. Anyway, so that was talking about fungible tokens. And examples of fungible tokens are things like DAI and Tether and USDC and things like that, because you can have multiple quantities of them. You can have 200 DAI or 1,000 DAI, and you can have 500 Tether or 5 million Tether, and so on and so forth. So that's all very well and good. However, now you can play the game of having a thought experiment, which is, what if I created a fungible token? And don't worry about the term fungible. It sounds a lot more complicated than really it. It just means that you can subdivide it and all the subdivisions have the same properties. What if I created a fungible token and I specified that the amount of that token that could be created is one, and that you can't have fractions of that token? Well, now you have a non-fungible token, because there's only one of them. It's unique, and it can only, in this particular example, if you're transferring over from the ERC-20 stand, you can only have one person owning that token. Now, there are clever things that you can do where you say, right, I'll have a contract hold that token, and then I'll allow multiple people to have a fraction stake in that token. But again, we could have a whole 20, 30 minute discussion about these kind of things. Anyway, you've created this token and there is only one. So there is a row in the spreadsheet that says this person owns this token. And if your smart contract is set up correctly, you can have a transfer function that then allows you to transfer that one token. And it has to be done in its entirety over to somebody else. Now they own it instead of you. And again, this is simply done by saying that the balance of the first person is reduced to zero. So in fact, they might even be totally wiped off the ledger that this non-fungible token contract instantiates. And the other person's address is put in its place. So this is great. Now you have a unique coin that you can transfer between people. But what would you want to do that for? Well, you could set up stuff such as saying, well, the person who can prove that they are the owner of this coin is the only person who can log into this server or something like that. So then it becomes a token that represents access to something. Another thing you can do is, because you've instantiated effectively a spreadsheet in your smart contract, you could say, well, I've got a field for the owner and I've got a field for the quantity they have. I could have another field and I can put in that field whatever I like. So let's put a link to an outside file in there. Now you've got the traditional non-fungible token that we're all familiar with from recent media hype, which is basically an entry in a database that says this person owns this token. Oh, and here's an extra piece of data which points off to a picture on a web server, for example. And that is the kind of token that people are selling as non-fungible tokens. And actually, there's a further level of redirection in there, because normally the link doesn't point to the image directly. It points to a file which contains a whole load of information, such as who created it, the date it was created on, and stuff like that. And it has a link in it that then points on to the image. So, and when you put it like that, non-fungible tokens probably don't seem as exciting as they did when you first heard about them, because really they are just rows in the database that say this person owns this row in the database, and here's a link to somewhere that contains something that might or might not be interesting to you. So there you have it in terms of sort of categories of high-level categories of tokens. Now, I've been going on for 10 minutes and I could now start talking about things such as governance tokens and wrapped tokens and stuff like that, but then it starts probably to get a bit too complicated for this video. Anyway, that's today's video. I hope that answered your question, and I hope the rest of you found that interesting. Maybe if there's some feedback, I might actually go on and make another video where I talk about all these esoteric tokens that exist that are built on the same principles as the three I've just described, namely native cryptocurrency, fungible token, and non-fungible token. But they come with extra superpowers attached, I suppose is the best way of describing it. So that's it for today, and look forward to seeing you in the next video soon. Bye for now.